Aktualizacja na sieci BitTensor Fini, 16 dzień marca, czwartek. To będzie ten dzień, gdzie będzie można oddelegować nasze tokeny do walidatorów, uzyskać staking. No i pewne zmiany nadeszły w tym ostatnim AMA, jakie się wydarzyło kilka dni temu. Chciałbym przedstawić najważniejsze informacje. Informacje, które są bardzo ważne co do wizji budowania sieci BitTensor, TAO, sztuczna inteligencja. Zapraszam na update numer 7, kryptospekulacja, Twitter, Telegram, YouTube. Wszystkie te informacje bierzemy na dwie strony płotu. A chociaż w kwestii TAO, BitTensor, te informacje wydają się być zdecydowanie najkorzystniejsze, prawdopodobnie, jeżeli chodzi o aspekt AI. Zapraszam na polskie community, to jest Discord, tam na oficjalnym BitTensor jest nasza polska społeczność i między innymi ta polska społeczność, a dokładnie Grzybomir, informuje, iż będzie własny walidator, gdzie będzie można stakeować nasze tokeny. Polski walidator, polska społeczność i tam ta delegacja, jak Grzybomir informuje, gdzie był, tak, z materiałem u Andrzeja, dzienna dawka dyskomfortu, tam na materiale. Myślę, że te update będą z jego strony informowane. Wszelkie pytania techniczne także tam znajdziemy ze strony Żywca czy Popka. No i też Telegram Żywiec Krypto informuje o ostatnie ogłoszenie co do nadchodzącej premiery Fini, aktualizacji. Bo jest bardzo ważna kwestia, nie ma tutaj już na ekosystemie Polkadot, a budowanie własnego blockchainu. I ten mechanizm konsensusu będzie zawarty. Dlaczego tak się stało? No to ten główny temat, jak tutaj przypominamy, to jest opóźnienia. Opóźnienia i te ostatnie kilka miesięcy nie jest odpowiednie dla BitTensora, bynajmniej na tym obecnym etapie, co nie wykluczają ewentualnego budowania w przyszłości z ekosystemem, integracją Fini, także z Polka. Dot. No i te zmiany, jakie mają nadchodzić, muszą być szybkie, nie mogą sprawiać opóźnień, także Popek, Telegram, różnego rodzaju informacje, te dwa linki, myślę, że przypnę w materiale. To są te dwie osoby, które należy śledzić w aspekcie TAO BitTensor. Czekamy na ten czwartek, 16 dzień marca, oficjalnie ruszymy z tą Fini, aktualizacją Fini na sieci BitTensor, ta infrastruktura modeli uczenia maszynowego. I czym jest Fini, czym jest BitTensor, jak te podsieci mają funkcjonować, na czym to polega, to te materiały także przypnę, te informacje w wcześniejszych update'ach będą. No i tym prostym językiem, no to właśnie, te podsieci subnetwork to są takie jakby pokoje, że tak powiem, w mniejszych społecznościach, mniejszych może uczeniach, aby bardziej było to wydajne i efektywne w przetwarzaniu określonych różnych typów danych. No i też Subnetwork Connect, czyli ta funkcja, która będzie umożliwiała mniejszym podsieciom łączenia się i udostępniania danych między sobą. Delegacja, staking, inteligentne kontrakty. I dlaczego ten Fini jest ważny dla sieci BitTensor? Stanowi ważny krok naprzód na całej decentralizacji AI, skalowalność, interoperacyjność. No i tutaj to kładzie podwaliny pod jej dalszy rozwój w przyszłości, czym jest delegacja w kontekście sieci BitTensor i jak sam Fini wpisuje się w przyszłe plany, aby ten swój cel osiągnąć, stworzenie zdecentralizowanego rynku inteligencji maszynowej. I te ostatnie AMA dwa dni temu. Materiał dość długi, ponad godzinny, jak widzimy, także cały materiał nie będziemy przeglądać, ale te najważniejsze kwestie, jakie zostały ujęte, no to zaczniemy. Tutaj mamy polskie napisy dla tych, co chcą także spoglądać na tłumaczenie, czy też aspekt anglojęzyczny, no to pozostawiam. I to będą urywki na temat tych najważniejszych informacji Fini.
I can answer that question then in the meantime, Mac. Yeah, so the plan was to go to Polkadot. And it's still...
I tutaj się odnoszę co do tej informacji właśnie na początku co do Polkadot i ekosystemu.
It's just that the time frame here has been changed. for the project. We needed to do a lot more investigation around what the limitations of working within the Polkadot ecosystem would mean for BitTensor. And that process was taking a fair amount of time for us because of the nature of Polkadot being kind of permissioned as a blockchain system. For instance, we ran into, back in January, we were hoping to launch Finny, but we ran into some issues with our slot that were very minor, and then we were delayed by some time. And that happened a number of times. And you know, in many ways, they were our errors. So, like, I don't want to make it seem like Polkadot as a technology is somehow flawed. It just is quite difficult to use, or it was difficult for us, and it didn't feel like the right direction to go when it came to, you know, last week us trying to launch on the Kusama. We ran into some more issues that delayed the chain, and it really made us you know, think about what we wanted to create here as an ecosystem. Did we want to be part of something that was going to hold us up for 2-3 weeks, months at a time? And there was going to be some limitations in the Polkadot ecosystem also about the computational side of BitTensor, like the size of the subnetworks that we could run. And that was just a function of the amount of compute that we could get onto a single block. So in the end, we decided that all in all, it was better for us to move more swiftly, to move without permission, to be more independent of a system that had these, you know, pitfalls for us as a project. That doesn't mean that we will necessarily always be away from Polkadot, or we will never connect into Polkadot in some way. It just means that right now it doesn't suit, you know, it doesn't suit our near-term goals as a project. You know, primarily what we want to focus on is a lot of machine learning, a lot of artificial intelligence, over, say, you know, integration into that ecosystem. So we picked the former over the latter as our priorities as a project, and so that's why we pivoted here. And, you know, the upside is that it allows us to just move really fast. So next week we can launch Finny, like, hands down, let's go. Let's get subnetworks, let's get staking, let's get delegation, let's get network connect, let's build registration networks, let's build multimodalities, let's have stable diffusion, let's have all these things. Instead of waiting for us to kind of work with a slow moving wheel of a network, let's just push ahead with what we see our main value as a digital currency system around artificial intelligence. So that's I think, you know, as much color as I can give to that in that answer.
No i to jest ta niezależność, którą BitTensor sobie w tym momencie wyzwolił w swoim aspekcie security. Powiedz co do security.
Yeah, so there's a few things I've already introduced into Infinity that increases some security, but the other, you know, there's no way around it. We are going to be losing out on Polkadot's shared security system that they've got set up, just because their system is so massive and so intricate that, you know, Finny won't be as large as Polkadot on launch, right? It's just not going to happen. But at the same time, launching into Finny will bring its own security upgrades on top of what already exists on Nakamoto anyways. So we are losing on Polkadot, but we're also bringing our own security on top of Finny, which we're actually going to be releasing more information on as that comes in.
No i wprowadzeniem własnych ulepszeń w sieci nowe funkcje.
Effectively what delegation does is it's going to be sort of a form of pooling. It's going to allow people to delegate their stake to a specific validator. And that validator's job will be to basically kind of stay honest on the network and actually contribute to the network's overall quality of things. Now, the nice thing about it is not only does it have economic incentives, it also creates this environment where validators will actually have to provide incentives for people to stake to them in the first place, right? So for example, if I'm, you know, let's say I'm some whale on the network and I want to start my own delegation, what am I giving back to my delegators, right? What am I giving to the people who are staking to my validator? Sure, they're getting some TAO back, but how am I contributing to the network as a whole, right? So there's more ways to hold myself accountable, and there's more ways to kind of contribute to the network and make it more honest as a result. And it'll also allow people with, for example, a little bit of TAO to also be able to stake and validate instead of having to mine from scratch. So basically, as we all know, mining from scratch right now has already become rather difficult as it is. Delegation will actually allow you to maybe hold a few TAO and then be able to earn on that TAO as you delegate to some bigger validator. Now with Finny, which is, at least to me, near and dear to my heart, more exciting is the subnets, right? So now you don't have just one massive network that can upload one massive monolith. Now you have small subnetworks, and there could be massive even subnetworks. But these subnetworks can actually take care of different aspects, right? So you can have a subnetwork dedicated to a specific form of burning. You can have a subnetwork dedicated to a specific form of fine-tuning a specific attack. You can even have a subnetwork specifically for a bunch of chat tensors, just talking to each other and learning from each other. So it kind of gives you a lot more degrees of freedom. And it's a lot like, at least in a way, it's analogous to somebody who's colorblind who kind of just put on glasses to actually see what colors actually look like. And that's actually what's going to be helping us realize the full potential of what we could do with the tensor, right? Because of all of these models that are coming in, treating them all on the same playing field like they have in Nakamoto is not really that optimal. It's actually suboptimal. Putting them into networks and kind of creating this, I want to say this intricate system of neighborhoods is actually going to create a much more cohesive environment for these networks to work together and to kind of enable everybody to participate in a meaningful way and create the high quality machine learning systems that we're looking for, these embeddings out of these models that we're looking for. And of course, live in a line also enable modalities. You can have subnets for audio, subnets for images.
No i te po trzeci bardzo ważny aspekt aktualizacji, jeżeli chodzi o rozwój, naukę, jeżeli chodzi o to.
And we're starting to see this appear in the research all throughout machine learning. It's not good enough to just work on language models. It's not good enough to just work on visual models. You need to be combining those modalities. I just was reading an announcement from Microsoft saying that GPT-4 is going to be a multimodal model. It's going to be an image model plus a text model. So subnets are working on the individual problems, but it's really going to be interesting when we're combining them. And that's going to happen on the API side. That's going to happen on the validator side, where people that have tau in the network can query these different modalities and combine the embeddings to do contrastive learning. So you'll be able to learn the relationships between images and images and text and do things like stable diffusion. That's all based on these fundamental components that we're mining within inside the subnetworks. At the same time, we can also make really high level subnetworks that are just doing sort of customer facing things like chat prompts. We can have a network that is answering questions like chat tensor is. And that's, when we spoke about this last Twitter space, we were talking about chat tensor in the release. A lot of people were upset about the fact that chat tensor wasn't built into the network. I mean, and that's why, and it was hard for us to be there, and we didn't want to lie because it wasn't. But the reason why we were sitting at that location was that we needed to wait for Finny to be launched before we could put chat tensor into it. So this is one of the things that we're going to launch immediately, is basically a subnetwork that works with more chat-based learning. We're going to work with a stable diffusion network. This is something I'm really excited about. I'm a visual learner. I'm a visual person. So I really want to see images generated on top of BitTensor and our subnetworks, and specifically with things like stable diffusion networks, mid-journey-like types of generation from text to image. That's what's really cool for me. A lot of these projects, if you look at, like, say, Stable Diffusion or Midjourney, great, give me one image. BitTensor's going to be able to give us 4096 images just by holding tau and querying the network. And I think that's really, really cool. We're going to see a lot of diversity. We're going to see a lot of different images that are going to come out of these different miners. That's, for me, the really exciting aspect of this kind of, like, pantheon of AI, the plethora of diversity that...
Tak, przechodząc do tej dyfuzji, wygeneracji obrazów, jaka będzie możliwość na tym etapie, to BitTensor wydaje się naprawdę kolosalne. Jeżeli chodzi o ten chat tensor, tutaj też mamy wypowiedzi, czyli tego bota.
More about chat tensor, because there does seem to be a little bit of a misunderstanding on how it works and how it's built, what the goal of it is. And I'd love to kind of dig into that a little bit, if that's cool.
Absolutely.
Awesome. So I think a lot of folks seem to think that, we build models on BitTensor from scratch, right? You have a model that knows nothing, and then it gets trained from zero, and it becomes magically super interesting and super super powerful. In the past, correct me if I'm wrong here on the dates constantly, but between 2012 to like 2017, that's how it was. If you understand a machine learning model, you just give it a data set, and you learn on it, and then you got your model. You're done. But today you can't do that, right? The tasks have gotten so much more complicated. And simply training a model from scratch is not really enough anymore, right? It needs a lot more nuances, a lot more power, and a lot more size. And some really smart folks admit to something called pre-training, which, if you think about it, pre-training is a lot like learning to read before you read a textbook. So it's basically taking a model that already knows something and then training it to be more, basically basically train attorneys to become really good at whatever task you want to do. So that's exactly what they did, basically, on a very basic level. That's what they did with ChatGPT, is that they took the pre-trained GPT-3, which, let's be honest, only they have access to, at least the version that was trained by OpenAI, and they fine-tuned it with prompts to get it to respond back and forth like a really intelligent chatbot. Now, this wasn't really optimal because OpenAI could have created the chatbot, the ChatGPT that had done this. It took millions of dollars to get there, right? So all this money, compute, and research really went into produce these embeddings, these high-quality embeddings that they want. And these are basically the outputs of GPT-3. And the higher quality they are, the more powerful the ChatGPT becomes. So ChatTensor, this is where it comes in, is actually a research project that we're creating specifically for Finney, right? It's already pre-trained on our partial data set and partial data sets that ChatGPT was trained on. But the main point is not to show off to the world and not to compete with ChatGPT in the first place, at least not at this stage. ChatGPT is actually intended to run Affinity to learn from all the subnetworks we're creating under Affinity. So once ChatGPT launches on Affinity and learns from models, it should become rather powerful and generic in that sense.
Tak, czyli dobrze to ujął, nauka czytania przed przeczytaniem książki. I to nie jest ich zadaniem na tym etapie, aby konkurować z ChatGPT OpenAI, a już ten sam rozwój powinien to krok po kroku przynieść i pojawić swoją moc, udoskonalać. Jeżeli chodzi o odnośnik co do słowa, jakie zostało użyte w poprzednich ich wypowiedziach co do spalania BR, tutaj się odnieśli, że to tak do końca nie wygląda. No i ten wycinek mamy w tym aspekcie. Aktualizacja z ich strony.
Was 50 Bitcoin per block, and then it was 25 and 12.5 and so on. We're working specifically at the inflation number. So it's 10.5 million tau that's going to be emitted at the current rate before we do the halving. So when we destroy tokens, we don't actually take it away from the 21 million. We just prolong the period of time that we're at the current rate of inflation, if that makes sense. So the total issuance is going to go down because those tokens have been effectively destroyed, but they just get pushed back into later in time. So they'll come out of the mechanism later on. So we'll get to 10.5 million, you know, in 6 years instead of 2 or 3.
Right. And I think that maybe burn might not be the best description for this.
Yeah, no, we have to be very careful with wording because it's like there's a lot of other projects in the space that have used that term for various reasons and various mechanisms. And I think people are afraid of it. It's a redistribution. So, yeah.
A recycling.
A recycling, you might say.
Well, yeah, I'm pretty excited about.
Czyli redystrybucja, a nie spalanie, to mieli w swoim aspekcie na wcześniejszych wypowiedziach. Jeżeli chodzi o nowych uczestników w aspekcie TAO, też była tutaj minuta odnośniku.
Need to have a test chain now, because we can build test subnetworks with 16,000 or 64,000 UIDs where people can play. And investigate how the system works and make, you know, small amounts of inflation before, you know, moving up the league, so to speak, into the more competitive systems. That's, you know, that's something that we're really excited about. It's something that was actually we were hindered in with the Polkadot system, primarily because they were going to limit the time we had on blocks. So 64,000 UIDs was actually out of reach for us. Until we had like basically re-architected our chain. So now having our solo chain, our independent chain, allows us to move up to 64,000, potentially even higher. You know, I don't know if I don't even think we need 64 or higher 1,000 networks, but maybe we do, you know, and we can investigate what that looks like and play around with that sort of horizontal scale.
Czyli ten odnośnik dla aspektu blokowania na ekosystemie Polkadot. Także odnośnik w kwestii sieci Nakamoto i tego przejścia na Fini.
How it's going to work. It's three steps, effectively. First is a snapshot. We'll take a snapshot of Nakamoto. That's everyone's balances, everyone's registrations, everyone's UIDs, yada, yada. Then we would stop Nakamoto. We would start up Fini. Then that import would happen right on boot of Fini. And as soon as we're confident we're producing blocks, we've done our integrity testing, then we can kind of move forward from there. Basically, what is going, the one part of the specifics that we're going to announce as well is which block or what time we're going to take the snapshot at. And after that point, it really won't matter in terms of mining and stuff like that, what you're doing, because we'll likely be turning off the validators a few blocks after that. So we'll specify exactly which number block or which hash we'll be picking it at. We'll let you know. And we'll be taking the snapshot likely Thursday in the morning, and then we'll do the port and we'll announce exactly what time it'll be launching. I think, Mac, you specified it's at 5 p.m. I, like to everyone in the call, I wouldn't take that as that's the time.
Tak, to będą informować co do snapshotu, jakie będzie wykonane. Kwestia fee, bo te fee też pojawia się w community dość wysokiego na chwilę obecną.
There's some comments here before we go. You know, there's some comments and questions in the comments here. One of them is about, are we reducing the fees? And the answer is yes. Hoorah.
Tak, te opłaty na pewno z ich strony, takie słowa padają, będą obniżone, no bo wyglądają dość spore jak na cenę TAO i szkoda swojego fee tracić z tokena TAO. Co do delegacji, walidatorzy i tu mamy wypowiedź 3-minutową, zapraszam.
How will you avoid validator centralization?
Tak, uniknięcie centralizacji walidatorów, to też jest dobre pytanie.
I think they're talking with respect to delegation.
How do we avoid validator centralization is the question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they're talking because it's going to be fewer validators. Their concerns are going to be centralization there.
Well, I think the question is, what do you mean by centralization here? Some people have said you need 1,000 unique parties to be considered decentralized. I think that there's, definitely less than that for BitTensor because we're going to have 100 slots from one perspective. But from another perspective, all of these validators are vying for delegated stake. And they have constituents in that sense, thousands of potential constituents. So by opening the delegative stake direction with Finney, I think that we've increased decentralization because now these validators have many more people that they are responsible for, many more delegators, people that are giving them TAO, that they're going to have to answer to. Whereas right now, it's not like that. And so I really think that Finney, even though we've likely reduced the number of absolute validators in the system, and that's a computational reason for that, I think that we've definitely opened up an aspect of decentralization with the delegative staking. We're going to have to kind of watch this play out. Building blockchains, we can really just guess to a certain degree. We can do analysis, but they're like living creatures. They have their own lives, and it's something that we're going to have to tweak. And if we see that kind of centralization, we can attack that centralization, and eventually. There'll be a lot more control for people in this call, probably, that are TAO holders to make, direct action into the protocol if that's what's needed to alleviate any centralization at the validator level. Because at the end of the day, it's about the decentralization of TAO that matters. Everything is, tied to or tethered to who owns the tokens. So as long as that's decentralized, I think we're sitting pretty going forward. And we've taken a lot of action to make sure that's the case. And one of the biggest ones we did was not do a pre-mine and ensure that there's many, many holders here, many people that have a lot of play in the system, a lot of power.
Tak, Paweł, czyli już ci walidatorzy i nasze tokeny, gdzie tam będą stake'owane, no i ta społeczność będzie miała wpływ, no i ta sama aktualizacja fini pod sieci na BitTensor. Jeżeli chodzi o nasze tokeny BitTensor na Polkadot, to też padło to pytanie, co z nimi?
Attention wallet, since you will not make use of Polkadot or Finny, should we remove our coins from there? If it's working on Nakamoto and it's working for you, I don't see a point why you should move anything because it should be compliant, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, just because we aren't merging with Polkadot at this time does not mean that your wallet needs to change. It's all gonna stay the same.
Yeah. It's basically if Sun is working for you in Nakamoto for the like from a infrastructure perspective, in terms of wallets, stuff like that, it should work just fine on Fini. There shouldn't be any changes that way.
Czyli jest ok, nie musimy nic zrobić, nie ma to wpływu na jakąkolwiek utratę. To nie jest to potrzebne, więc spokojnie, bez obaw. Chat Tensor, wersja beta, ta wersja beta też padło to pytanie i to mamy w tym momencie teraz.
When will be beta Chat Tensor ready for public testing? So we have the beta is, the invites are coming out to beta slowly, they're trickling out. And then we'll be, you know, kind of releasing a more public beta in the coming weeks.
Tak, w najbliższych tygodniach publiczna wersja beta, więc po aktualizacji sieci BitTensor będziemy czekać. Tutaj było też pytanie z jednego użytkownika na Twitterze. Dość prozaiczne co do ilości tokenów.
There are no stupid questions. I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I can hear you.
So now that the staking mechanism will be introduced, there's no plans on changing the max supply of TAO, correct? It's going to stay the same.
No, max supply of TAO remains the same. So total supply is going to be 21 million. That doesn't change anything.
21 million or 200 million?
200 million or 21? 21.
Yeah, Okay, perfect.
I jeszcze jedno było pytanie też z strony użytkownika.
Okay, I can ask the real stupid question.
Go ahead.
I found you guys through the meaning of TAO. All right.
Tak, i to też takie pytanie jakby ze strony laika jest nowe, jak zacząć w aspekcie kopania ewentualnego TAO.
I need an explanation like I'm 5. How do I get started?
Oh. I can take
this one.
Yeah, go for it.
So if you want to get started as a server and you want to serve your machine learning model, there are a couple ways you can approach it. You can dive in and try to use all the public tools available to you and use the CLM model tuning script on our documentation to fine tune an open source model. Or you can jump straight into the academics and start learning machine learning from scratch. There are a lot of resources you can find online. The Coursera course with Andrew and is really great. I've personally taken it. There's usually classes at local universities you can take, but that's what you need to get started as a server, and you will also need compute, so GPUs.
Okay, so I have the server, I have GPUs. So I should go through your website to get started?
Yes, bittensor.com.
Okay.
Tak, jak zacząć, to te odnośniki, a także polska społeczność na Discordzie, tam zapraszam. Bowiem ci nowi, którzy potencjalnie mają zaczynać, już te koszty wyglądają inaczej, niżeli na początku, ale nie oznacza to, że jest się na późnym etapie. No i na koniec jeszcze jedno ucięcie co do Chat Tensora i jego użycia. I zobaczmy, i to było to dość interesujące pytanie i interesująca odpowiedź. Ta różnica chociażby między OpenAI a ChatTensor, jaka jest kluczowa i samego rozwoju.
I just have a question. So basically when ChatTensor is released, I'm just wondering, like how is it going to improve over time? Is it just kind of like similar to ChatGPT, the more people that use it, the more data? And then is there going to be revenue from people using that, like if people are paying a subscription, or how would that work out?
So Const might be better to speak on that one. I'm not sure if you heard him, Const, but basically
I didn't hear him.
So he was asking basically if ChatTensor would work like in a reinforcement learning kind of way where it would learn from people talking to it, and if it's going to be on Fini, and if it's if there's going to be some kind of subscription model. So subscription model, I can tell you there's no, at least not a traditional one, so you don't have to kind of like put in your credit card and use it kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But to gate, like similar to anything we do on BitTensor, gating access to the network is TAO. So basically to be able to run your own chat tensor on Fini, you would need some TAO to actually get in, right? Through the registration or through basically in the network itself.
No i to ważny element, że opłat nie będzie, tak? Jak widzimy, słyszymy, czytamy z naszych kart jakichkolwiek płatnościowych, ale poprzez płatność TAO, tak, czyli tokenów, aby wejść i móc rozwój tego chat tensora dokonywać.
But as for the reinforcement learning bit, I think that's more cons territory. Maybe you can speak more of that.
Well, yeah, a couple things. I mean, the current implementation of chat tensor is email based and it's beta based because it's really, we were really experimenting here, and it was a great success. But we, you know, are just pulling people in slowly as we build the front end and, you know, make the system a lot more polished. We will be building an application like Chat Tensor that's much more polished and also way more integrated inside of the BitTensor ecosystem that's TAO based in access. Now, like the economic model is that, you know, right now with the embeddings network, Chat Tensor doesn't work very well with it right now. That's a bit of a longer experiment. We're going to be producing a subnetwork that works with prompts. And at that point, you will be able to access the network in the standard way, like through the main protocol, which is if you hold TAO, you can access the system. And that's just innate, right? That just works through BitTensor. It doesn't matter if you use our front end or not. It's just like there. And it's censorship resistant, and you don't have to ask us.
The censorship thing that you...
That's like V2. You know, V1 is the beta. V2 is you know, updated front end and more people, and it's much more open. And V3 is you know, a subnetwork where we're seeing a lot more bandwidth to the chat tensor, and also it's censorship resistant. So don't come to us to see if you can get beta. It doesn't fucking matter who we are. It matters if you own TAO, if you are in the network. So...
Speaking of the censorship
question, which
Cox, I think Akido has another question about censorship.
Yeah, I was just because I seen basically the main concern right now with OpenAI.
I can't hear them, unfortunately.
Oh.
Well, I'll repeat the question to you. Go ahead, okay. Akido.
It's basically just about kind of the censorship and stuff, because a big issue with OpenAI right now is it's very one-sided. As you can see, kind of like liberal, I guess you could say. So it limits a lot of stuff. I mean, some things that it limits, it's like dangerous stuff, like how to make bombs or whatever, that I can understand. But you can see it's very one-sided, at least politically. So it's just BitTensor or ChatTensor is going to be like raw, zero censorship, ask it anything, or?
Right, okay. So Kant, what he's asking is ChatTensor going to censor its responses, and can UIDs on the network be censored?
Right, it's a really good question. Because Chat Tensor, the application front end that's really nice to use, is going to be run by a front end, which is going to be owned by a person and likely a company who's using their TAO to access the network, it's their prerogative to censor. And you know, I might say that there'll be some good censorship here, right? You know, there's likely that some of the miners could be, you know, responding to some really atrocious stuff. So we'll want a little bit, but it's a prerogative of the validator which has the access. If you are a validator, if you have access to a validator, or if you're staked to a validator, you'll likely get the access that they provide, because you're basically, they're middling you to the network. If you're a validator, you can just query the network directly, right, and everyone will respond. Sometimes people will respond anyways, because it's very possible for you to host a model on BitTensor and just accept queries from people without them being a validator, right? So there could be no censorship at all from that aspect. For the miner side, censoring the miners, this comes down to, you know, really the core of what BitTensor is, because BitTensor is a mechanism for the validators to reach consensus on the outputs of the miners and to agree on which ones they prefer. So if there is consensus amongst the validators as to what should and should not be said on BitTensor, then that model will lose its incentive. Doesn't mean that the axon has to go offline. Doesn't mean that the model is not going to, you know, be able to be served somewhere. It just means that it won't be incentivized in through BitTensor. And that's the nature of the consensus mechanism that we built. Thankfully, that's fairly decentralized, right? Because there's a number of players, and there, it's not just a single person that gets to decide, you know, what gets value and what doesn't. And that's good. And that's like the nature of decentralized consensus, is, you know, the decentralization of power. And therefore, you know, it's harder to just censor ideas or speech that you disagree with because it affects you, right? You have to reach consensus amongst the other people that are also stakeholders in the system. So I can see a form of censorship arising at the level of the applications and the validator heads. But only through consensus would it occur actually on the network. So the network will likely remain quite violent, if that word makes sense. I think that we're going to like hope that we get a fair amount of censorship when it comes to images as well. And it will be the, you know, our front ends that do that type of censorship.
Maybe we should stay away from a word like violent. Maybe let's call it unfriendly.
Yeah, I mean, it's like the network is sort of like not a safe space, if you think about it, because the censorship, but the safe space is the applications that the validator is built on top, right? So people can choose the level of censorship they want by picking the validator heads that you know, speak their language and are part of their culture or whatever that you know, comes down to. But the protocol itself doesn't censor anything. Like the miners can use the protocol, the wire protocol, all they want. You know, it's only the consensus that would actually push something out.
Yep, that's awesome. I really like that. Thank you guys for that. And
tak, i sam protokół, decentralizacja. I może być dość brutalna sieć, jak to nazwał, czyli ci walidatorzy, większy walidatorzy, te podsieci, jak to odniósł się do cenzury ewentualnej, że może będzie taką niecenzurą. No, dajmy typu zdjęć, nie wiem, pornograficznych, erotycznych, że to będzie brutalna sieć wszystkich faktów. I rzeczywiście, no, powinna ta cenzura może nie być, bo nie da się jej ograniczyć, ale zapytanie jakiekolwiek, czy na pewno chcesz to uzyskać, ten dostęp, jak mogliście usłyszeć, czy też przeczytać. I czym te podsieci są, tutaj fajnie użytkownik Basman TV na Twitterze wyjaśnił. Możemy sobie wyobrazić, że jesteśmy na imprezie, gdzie jest masa ludzi i nie możemy z wszystkim jednocześnie rozmawiać, czy też każdy rozmawia z każdym, próbując uzyskać w tym samym czasie swój efekt. No i to takie jakby pokoje, że tworzymy pokoje i dani uczestnicy imprezy dzielą się na poszczególne tematy w tych pokojach, tam prowadzą swoją konwersację i tym samym trzymając fokus, rozwój, produktywność i ta różność grup użytkowników. Czy też drugie porównanie, jesteśmy w tak na zatłoczonym mieście i mamy te różne linie dla busów, taksówkarzy, szybsze linie, swoje pasy. Tak logistycznie to ujmuje Basman, na czym ten subnetwork wygląda. Ten chat tensor, jego pytania uzyskujemy w różnych aspektach, nawet tych aspektach tradingowych, analizy technicznej. Dość interesujący temat, jak będzie się rozwijał pod kątem tradingu nawet. Także ostatni użytkownik BlueGantT na Twitterze. Tych tematów jest sporo, zagłówków jest sporo, co nam ten ostatni właśnie wywiad na BitTensor Space przyniósł. Krótkie podsumowania tekstowe. Dla nas najważniejszy to ten właśnie staking. Ale sam techniczny aspekt jest bardzo, bardzo ważny. I nawet community zarzuciło to zdjęcie, przedstawiając potencjalny market cap, supply. No i rok 23, jaka cena może być osiągnięta. Chyba ta cena jest obecnie w $70 przy market cap, jeżeli będzie w roku 24, 5 na naszą potencjalną hossę. Czy taka cena faktycznie, czy to jest realistyczne ujęcie? Nie wiem, każdy do własnej analizy. Myślę, że nie. Myślę, że weźmiemy tak w ciemno nawet tą kwotę $4000 czy $2000, nie mówiąc tutaj o $12000. No i też community zwraca uwagę, aby pamiętać o tych oto osobnikach bitcoinowych.
I'm right here watching history be made. Bitcoin is now up to $111. It's an all-time high, and it's continuing to rise. I've seen it break 3 times today. It went up to 110, and this is the highest that it's been. It's ridiculous.
Takie historyczne porównanie TAO w tym momencie ceny. Wiem, jaka jest ekonomia, jaki jest schemat TAO w porównaniu do Bitcoina. Czy tak będzie za 10 lat? Będziemy wspominać cenę TAO. A może za 5 lat? I don't know. Jest ryzyko. Ale tą szansę sobie dajemy. I myślę, że z argumentami, fundamentami. Oczywiście bierzmy dwie strony płotu. Ale uważam, że TAO BitTensor faktycznie jest godne uwagi. Będziemy przyglądać się dalej i już po aktualizacji sieci BitTensor Fini. Kolejny update. Pozdrawiam, do usłyszenia, ahoj.